Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I wonder if I can have your attention. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Winchelsea tonight. My name's Sandra Jones, and I'm the President of the Business and Tourism Association. It's my pleasure to welcome you all to Winchelsea for our coal seam and other conventional gas forum. We hope you will find the information, the evening informative as well as entertaining. I would like to acknowledge Councillor Rose Hodge, Mayor of Surf Coast Shire, and other Shire councillors, Heather Wellington, Eve Fisher, Clive Goldsworthy, Libby Coker, and Surf Coast CEO, Mr. Stephen Wall. We also have present a number of senior officers from Surf Coast Shire, Colac West Shire and Golden Plains Shire, and many members of the Winchelsea community and the wider Surf Coast community, and people from other districts. There's been a lot of discussion in our community about this topic, as we know, and we're very pleased to be able to present this to you tonight. You will have the opportunity to hear from and pose questions to our panel. Our forum will conclude at 8 o'clock. I would like to acknowledge that all our panel members are donating their time and expertise to assist our community in understanding this very topical and emotional issue. On behalf of the association, I welcome the panel members to Winchelsea and thank you all for your willingness to take part in this event. I also welcome Mr. John Fain. As most of you would know, John has hosted ABC Melbourne's morning radio show for many years, as you will probably know. He is a lawyer. Now, I didn't write this. He is a lawyer and highly experienced broadcaster who is well known for his keen intellect and penetrating questioning. John, we're delighted to have you, that you've agreed to come and moderate our evening. Ladies and gentlemen, to introduce our panel, to explain the rules of the forum, and to moderate the debate, please welcome John Fain.
Thank you, Sandra. It's the last time I want to hear anyone say anything about me. We have a fabulous panel here, and the idea of this meeting is that you have a chance to ask them questions after you have heard from them. A couple of quick formalities. Could everyone in the room please do us the courtesy of attending to your mobile phone? There is nothing worse than being interrupted by the appalling ringtones that you've all chosen to install on your phones. It's really avoidable. There is a function on the phone that none of us ever use. It's the off button. You can even use that, you know, or silent. Sandra, thank you for your welcome. And I have also been asked to pass on one apology, which is from the local member of Federal Parliament for this seat, Sarah Henderson, who rang me a short while ago. She's in Canberra. She'd like to be here. She's not able to be here. She asked me to pass on some other views and sentiments, and I declined to do so and said it was not my role to make a speech on her behalf. I'd also like to acknowledge the traditional owners and of this land and pay respect to their elders. I'd ask you to respect the rules which have been drawn up for today. It is democracy in action. We should be extremely proud, every single one of us, that we're able to meet over something that is as potentially divisive an issue as this and one that people feel as strongly about. But we can respect other people's views and acknowledge that they are free to express them. You might be free to agree or disagree, but we do want to hear what people have got to say. So the rules are, I think they're laid out for everybody. I don't need to read them, do I? But I shall not hesitate to enforce them. The proceedings are being recorded. There's a camera at the back. If anyone's uncomfortable about that, then you can indicate to one of the organisers afterwards. And the panel have very generously agreed that they can be filmed, and that's for the purpose of a webcast, and there's an overflow room if indeed more people turn up than we can fit. And just finally from me, curiously, just today the state government made a significant announcement about this very topic and announced that there was a deferral of any approval. approvals, there's a moratorium on coal seam gas, which is to be extended to 2015, which takes this issue out of consideration as an issue during the state election, even though I suspect that there's not a lot of difference between the major parties on their policies. But either way, it takes it out as an issue. We have five guests who will speak to us, and the rules are very simple. They will speak for 5 minutes, and 5 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, is five. It's not six, it's not 7 minutes, it's 5 minutes. I'll ask a question or two arising from their address. We'll hear from all five of them. If we have some points to clarify amongst the panel, we'll ask them to do so, and then I'll open it up to your questions. The only rules about questions are very straightforward ones. I'm asking you not to make a speech from the floor. I'm asking you to ask a question. And I'm asking you not to ask a question of the entire panel, because that's five questions. I'm asking you to choose which member of the panel you're addressing your question to. And you can leave it to my discretion if someone other than the person you're asking it to has a contribution to make as the answer. There are two microphones on either side of the room, and I'll indicate when it's time, which is towards the end of the fifth speaker, when you can go and form an orderly crush at either one of those two. Any questions? No? Good. Excellent. I feel like an auctioneer up here, actually. It's really quite cute. Our first speaker is Professor Damien Barrett. He's a Senior Principal Research Scientist with the CSIRO. He leads a team of researchers aiming to provide Australians with independent advice underpinned by science on the issue of water management. He's also Director of the Gas Industry Social and Environmental Research Alliance, a vehicle initiated by Australia Pacific LNG and CSIRO to foster collaborative public research into the social and environmental challenges and opportunities associated with Australia's growing gas industry. Damien, thank you for coming, and your time starts now.
Thank you for having me here tonight. This is a great opportunity to talk to you and inform you about the science associated with unconventional gas extraction. We call it unconventional gas because it is consists of coal seam gas. Shale gas and tide gas. To put it in perspective, Australia consumes about 6,000 petajoules of energy a year, but our production is about three times that. It's about a little bit over 17,000 petajoules of energy. So we're a major energy exporter. The world demand for energy is a bit over 500,000 petajoules. So Australia uses around about 1% of global energy. And the demand for energy is rising, and it's rising particularly strongly in Asia, in Southeast Asia, in China, and Japan. And it's the combination of that demand price, which is making an opportunity, a window of opportunity, open at this time that is being exploited by production of coal seam gas, particularly in Queensland. We're producing over the next 10 years or so around about 16,000 petajoules of gas. So it's about the same amount that Australia generates per year as it stands at the moment. That 16,000 petajoules goes to filling external contracts. In contrast, domestically we use about 151 petajoules of gas, so it's a very small amount. Our reserves of gas are in the order of just under 50,000 petajoules, that's as CSG, but we may have up to something like 125,000 petajoules worth of CSG. On top of that, we've got just under 500,000 petajoules of shale gas. About 60% of that is in the Canning Basin in Western Australia. About a fifth of it is in the Cooper, which is South Australia and Western Queensland, and about 15% of that is in the Perth Basin. puts it into perspective, the combination of the market, the demand externally to Australia, and Australia's immense resources of gas are what are driving this this appearance of the industry in the landscape. Previously, Australia has supplied gas overseas and to its domestic market, but it's been conventional gas, it's been gas that's produced offshore, and we don't see it. Now we're seeing gas produced onshore, and the industry is becoming our neighbours. In CSIRO, we undertake research, public good related research, that's in the national interest, and this is obviously in the national interest. I'm actually Deputy Director of the Energy Flagship in CSIRO, and in the organisation, the type of research we undertake there ranges from the characterisation of those resources, better improved engineering methods for drilling, improved methods for hydraulic fracturing that are particularly directed at Australian conditions, all the way through to the environmental and social impacts of gas production. So what I'm hoping to do tonight is answer a range of questions associated with the environmental and social impacts, the things that are worrying you about gas development, particularly in Victoria, but in Australia in general. And I hope that when you leave here tonight, you'll have an improved understanding in terms of the amount of information that you have so you can make your decisions when you leave.
Thanks, Damien. Thank you, Damien. Would you describe the technology as it stands now as being mature? If you have a look, for instance, at the technology and its evolution for drilling for oil or mining for coal or uranium, it's gone through various transitions, and you start off with something that's maybe not been done very well, and gradually over time you have a few disasters here and there, and the world learns how to do it better. Where are we? How mature a technology is this?
The petroleum production globally is nearly about 200 years old. The easy to get at resources are the conventional resources. We've utilised, extracted the large majority of those, and those resources are declining. The shale gas in particular resource is in fact increasing. Our ability to extract shale gas is increasing into the future. So about 10 years ago we were talking about peak oil. There is no talk about peak oil anymore. The production of oil and gas from shale is sufficient to meet humans' needs going up into the next century. The development of the technology, hydraulic fracturing, for instance, the first hydraulic fractures were done in reservoirs back in the 1940s. And the technology has been developed. Particular advances were made in the 1990s. Directional drilling, so wells are able to be drilled horizontally now into shale. And hydraulic fracturing methods have improved to the point now where over about the last 15 or so years there have been over 1 million hydraulic fractures in the United States alone. So it's and I can talk later about the environmental impact of that, but in terms of maturity, it's a technology that is improving all the time, but it has certainly been around for quite a few decades.
Would you describe it as safe technology?
Well, it depends. It depends what you mean and define by the term safe.
Okay. Well, we think our cars are safe. That doesn't mean there aren't accidents.
That's
some
right.
Things can go wrong, but by and large, most of us every day we trust the technology of a motor vehicle. And yet, when cars were first invented, there was a person with a red flag walking in front because they didn't want to start the horses. So, you know, these things evolve over time. They get to the point where they're accepted, and pretty much everyone in this room every day trusts the technology of the motor vehicle.
Yeah. There are risks in every endeavour. There are risks in question is, are the risks acceptable in terms of their environmental and social impacts? And that's going to be weighed up in terms of the consequences in a negative and positive sense. So there are enormous economic benefits associated with extraction of resources. Australia has done very well out of its abundant resources. But there are also consequences or negative impacts.
Well, if you're a Turkish coal miner, you're not going to increase the safety of coal mines this week, are you?
Certainly. Well, safety is another issue in the coal industry. But that's right. I mean, the environmental regulation in Australia is quite different to elsewhere in the world. We have some of the most rigorous environmental and safety regulation here. And the sort of accident that we saw in Turkey would be highly unlikely in Australia.
All right.
But it's about weighing up the costs and benefits and then making a decision whether the benefits outweigh the costs.
Thank you, Damien. I'm sure there'll be questions for you later on. Our second speaker is Professor Samantha Hepburn. She's the Associate Head of Deakin University Law School. She's published many scholarly articles and books examining different aspects of Australian land and property law, environmental property and natural resource management. Her doctorate and subsequent publications examine the ongoing suitability of common law principles to the unique Australian landscape, with a particular emphasis upon newly emerging land interests, and her specific research interest is the existing and emergent regulatory framework for coal seam gas and its mining in Australia. Sam, thank you.
Thank you very much, and thanks for the opportunity.
Let's put your mic in. Can we make sure that one's working?
That's fair. Thanks for the opportunity. It's great to be here. I'd just like to start off by saying I've got 5 minutes, so I'm going to get as much in as I can. We need to use regulation. I'm going to be looking at the regulatory side of things. We need to use regulation as a positive tool for the development of unconventional gas. Damien's just told us that there's a lot of it in Victoria. And if it's going to be developed, then we need to make sure we have an input into how the regulation is framed. I would argue strongly that the current framework is weak and it needs significant improvement. And we need to move towards an optimum regulatory framework. So let's start off with looking at access rights. I'm just going to be very brief here, so I'm not going to sort of bog you down in the detail. But to start with, the ownership framework that exists in Australia is a public ownership framework. And what that basically means is that land tenure is separated from minerals. So mineral rights and petroleum are vested in the Crown. The Crown then has the right to issue out mining licences to proponents who satisfy the requirements under the Act. The mining licence, whether it be an exploration licence or a production licence, will then confer on the mining title holder rights to carry out authorised activities. Okay? So the bottom line is you don't actually own the minerals and the petroleum that reside underneath your land. Now the difficulty is the interface. How do you deal with that problem? Because you've often got, you know, and I can't even imagine to consider, I should say, all of the different circumstances that people find themselves in with established industries, agriculture, you know, a whole range of different types of surface estate activities that are impacted by the extraction process. So the difficulty is making sure that our regulatory framework properly protects the rights of the surface estate holders when those extraction rights are exercised. Now, we don't have really anything at all at the moment. There's an access code that exists in Queensland, which at least sets out the sorts of entitlements that everyone would want to know about. When, where, how, what the scope of the actual authorised activity might be. And this is something that has to be negotiated in a fair and reasonable manner with the landholder before the process begins. And we don't have that in the existing regulation in Victoria. So that's a problem. In terms of, I know lots of people say, well, what can I do? You know, I'm going to say no. And look, you can say no. Of course you can say, oh, you're not coming on my land. And it's a perceptual thing. It is, you know, the sense of ownership that you have. You've had it for a long time. You might have had it for you know, generations. And all of a sudden you receive this notice saying, you know, this is happening. What can I do? Well, you can say no, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it will stop the authorised activities from going ahead. And that comes back to the framework that I've just explained to you. So what can happen is that if you don't give your written consent, or in fact, verbal informed consent for low impact exploration activities, is all that's required under the existing act, then the mining proponent can go to VCAT to get authorisation. They will have to enter into a compensation agreement. Okay, so if you don't say, if you don't allow it, then it's going to go to VCAT, and generally a compensation agreement will be issued, and then that assumes that you've consented. That's the way the framework exists at the moment. It's a sort of a strange framework because it seems to yoke together compensation with access. Anyway, 1 minute. Okay, so quickly, compensation. The compensation framework also needs to be improved. The GAS Task Force report recommended increasing loss of amenity from 10,000 to 20,000, which is one possible issue, possibly not enough. There are huge concerns with the type of compensation that landholders experience. It's also quite concerning that there is no mandated compensation agreement. In Queensland, for example, you have to enter into an access and compensation agreement before the activities, the authorised activities under the licence can commence. So we don't have that protection in Victoria. So I think that's an important thing to think about as well. If I could just move forward, one other thing I'd like to see
5 seconds.
Is the expansion of compensation to include legal costs associated with negotiating this.
Thank you, Sam. Just to interrupt, there's about 30 or 40 people standing around the edge of the room. There are lots of empty seats in some of the middle of the rows. If people who have empty seats in the row move into the middle, that'll free up seats at the end, and some of those people won't have to stand for the rest of the hour or longer that we've got, and that'll free some seats up. If you could just assist your neighbours and the friends, I'm sure they would be grateful to you. Sam, a couple of questions then for you arising from what you have just told us. First of all, should, in your view, Victoria just simply, rather than reinvent the wheel, should we simply adopt a code based on the Queensland one?
Look, definitely. I mean, whether we want to develop a code that's specifically adapted for sort of conditions that relate to Victoria is probably a slightly separate question, but I would like to see a code. The Reef Report didn't recommend a code. It recommended a gas commission. But in Queensland, you have a gas commission combined with a code, and a code is extremely important for protecting the sorts of problems that can occur and the sorts of conflicts that can arise when you have that interface between the mining licence and the access rights and landholders, you know, feeling disengaged from the whole process.
Can you define or explain how you work out what is fair and reasonable? Words that readily roll off the lawyer's tongue, but sometimes no one knows what they mean.
Yes. You know, fundamentally, you could argue, and from a property point of view, I don't think it works. I don't think this division between subsurface minerals and land tenures really works. It's a very complex arrangement, and inevitably there's going to be dispute and conflict. How do we make it fair? The very first step is to make sure that landholders and their tenure are carefully protected. So when I say protected, your underlying property rights aren't diminished and aren't affected, other than you don't own minerals, and maybe you thought you did. But what you need really is to have a very strong input into the way in which mining license holders are going to be accessing and you know, impacting on the sorts of activities that you've been carrying out on your land. So yes, the legislation precludes you at the moment, precludes the mining license holder at the moment from drilling within 100 metres of a dwelling residence. But the definition of works excludes low impact exploration activities.
And access roads?
Yeah, access roads are crucial. One of the issues that I had some feedback from a Queensland solicitor working in the area, he was saying it just the whole environment changes. So, you know, you've got roads, and one lady was saying that every single day she'd drive a car out and she'd get a flat tire. You know, that just happened, I reckon, because of the debris that was being dropped. So those sorts of practical structural issues are extremely important to anticipate within a new regulatory framework.
And just finally, you suggested that you thought the compensation thresholds were inadequate.
Yep.
Have you got a suggestion on where you think they should be pegged?
I don't necessarily think there should be a threshold. I think that...
Unlimited?
Yes, definitely. And I think we need to take into account... When we say unlimited, I just think that imposing a threshold suggests that that's, you know, the only time. I mean, if you can establish a significant loss of amenity, why should it be capped at 20,000? It may well be that your surface industry or your activities in those that unique type of activity goes beyond that. I also think that it's crucial, and Queensland has recognised this as well, to include legal costs. This is something which is a big concern for landholders. They don't know, they may not have those sort, that sort of money to begin with.
Particularly when the legal costs of the mining company are a tax deductible business expense, but not necessarily for the people on whose land they're mining. Thank you, Sam. There are some seats. If people don't want to stand for the rest of the meeting, we have freed up some seats. Feel free to use them. Our third speaker is Mr. Mark Rowe from the Australia Institute. He's a researcher and public engagement officer for the Canberra-based think tank, the Australia Institute, but Mark is based in Melbourne. He's also an artist and a former operations director at Beyond Zero Emissions, where he helped initiate and direct the award-winning Zero Carbon Australia 2020 project. His work involves communication of key research findings about the impact of the mining boom on other crucial sectors of the Australian economy, especially the impact on manufacturing, tourism, education and agriculture. And Mark, thank you.
Great. Thanks, John. I just wanted to begin by describing a little bit the physical infrastructure that we're talking about, because as Samantha said, you know, it does really change the whole physical environment of an area. So shale gas and tight gas fields tend to have, you know, typically have thousands of wells, and they tend to be fairly closely spaced wells. Every single well is connected by access roads, gas pipes, there's water treatment facilities and ponds to hold the, you know, the toxic water. And every single well is fracked, some of them multiple times. So, and every time you frack one of those wells, you need somewhere between 11 and 30 million litres of water, and so that can be hundreds of truckloads, so it has a huge impact on traffic. There's a large amount of chemical use, according to Frack Focus, which is an industry-funded website in the US, a gas industry-funded website. They use 80 to 330 tonnes of chemicals for every frack as well, so there's a heavy industrial chemicals. So, you know, it really does transform the landscape into an industrialised area. Now, as Damien said, you know, there's huge economic benefits from these projects, and that's the justification essentially for the projects. But the real question is, you know, where do those economic benefits flow through? Because if they're all captured by the gas industry, then, you know, it might not be in the community's interest to approve them. I'll just start, one of the main strands is jobs. So jobs are often talked about by the gas industry. It's important to realise, to put it into perspective, well, the jobs in the gas industry are important jobs. Everyone's jobs are important. But nationally, they employ 0.2% of the Australian workforce. When these projects come to town, almost all the jobs are in construction because they don't need a lot of a large operational workforce, and experience around Australia shows that they're almost entirely non-residential, so fly in, fly out, or drive in, drive out. Another thing to bear in mind in the local community is that the companies will quote a certain amount of jobs but don't expect them to be new jobs. They will employ people in the local community, but they need skilled workers, so they'll often employ people who are already in other sectors, you know, and that will have impacts on the businesses that they're drawing those workers from. The other big thing often cited is economic activity. The gas industry does generate a lot of economic activity, and it's measured as gross state product or gross domestic product, but we have to kind of dig a bit deeper into what that is and look where those benefits go. The gas, oil and gas industry in Australia is 83% foreign owned, so that means 83% of the profits go offshore. When a Korean power company buys gas from Shell, say for Queensland CSG, the cheque will go from Korea to the Shell office in the Netherlands. It doesn't reach Australia, but it's counted as gross state product or gross domestic product. Supply chains, these are global gas and oil majors, so the supply chains tend to be international. And so, you know, a lot of stuff is imported from overseas. There's not a lot of purchases from the local supermarket. And the other thing that, because we've chosen to build a ridiculous, it might be a ridiculous, irresponsible amount of gas projects simultaneously in Australia, we're going to overtake Qatar as the largest LNG exporter in the world in a few years. Because we've chosen to do that, it's driven a huge skills shortage, which has had a really severe impact on the manufacturing and agricultural sectors in particular. In a local town, some businesses, farmers and some small businesses will suffer from the skills shortage and difficulty getting contractors, etc. If you've ever lived through a construction boom, you'll know some of those difficulties. Some businesses, like motels, bars and fast food chains, will do pretty well, particularly in the short term. But what you have to remember is the construction boom only lasts a little while, so after that there's often an oversupply of those businesses. And the tourism industry is an interesting one because it tends to get crowded out during the construction phase. So if you're a tourist operator and you're relying on people staying overnight in the area, then you could be in trouble because all the motels and caravan parks, etc., tend to be booked out for that initial period. And in the long term, with tourism, if you rely on a clean, green environment, then an industrialised landscape would be a real minus. Thanks. When you say it's an industrialised landscape, Gippsland is one of the most tourist-friendly, productive and green farming communities in Victoria, and is also the site of the Latrobe Valley Power Stations. So you can have industrialised landscape coexisting with everything that you're saying is mutually exclusive to it. There's an example of where the two can be side by side.
So you can certainly have industrial landscape side by side with rural landscape. The big difference with gas is that these gas fields cover, you know, in Queensland they're going to cover tens of thousands of square kilometres.
Last time I looked, the coal power stations and mines down in the Latrobe Valley were pretty big.
Yeah, but they're not covering tens of thousands of square kilometres. They're concentrated into a small area. I actually think, you know, they're not a great, you know, brown coal power plants aren't a great thing long term for power generation. But the gas industry, the footprint of the gas industry is absolutely vast. And I just want to, about coexistence with the gas industry is very different from coexistence with other industries, because no other industry can come onto land owned by other people or other businesses, whether you like it or not, and build heavy industrial infrastructure. And no other industry, as far as I know, is allowed to drill a hole in the ground and pump hundreds of tonnes of industrial chemicals into the ground. So it's quite a different coexistence. It kind of sounds nice, and you know, a lot of people might be happy with that because there are some economic benefits from it. You get paid for the gas wells, etc. But people should understand what that coexistence means.
All right, another of your points was that where do the benefits go was a question that you asked.
Yeah.
Well, surely in any venture of this kind, the benefits go to the people who take the risk and put up the capital. That's how our system works. It's called capitalism.
That's absolutely right. And I guess the question is, when you approve something that has a big impact on a lot of people, when the regulators or the government approve these projects, what they have to judge is whether it's in the interest of the country and the state and the community. And if the benefits are all flowing to the people who have taken the risk, as they, you know, rightly do in businesses, then the regulators should say, well, you know, they've still got to look at what the benefits are to Australia.
Australia and to the state and the community. And that's what they need to be making a judgment on. And what I'm saying is that because the benefits, because essentially these companies have to spruik their economic benefits to get approval, they tend to focus on the benefits and sometimes exaggerate them, and they don't talk much about the economic downside. And as with any huge thing that happens, there is a downside and there is losses to other industries.
And you seem to criticise the industry because it may turn into a boom. There are ways of managing booms, and there are ways of having an industry grow in a more long-term, sustainable fashion whilst ironing out the peaks and troughs of a boom. We've seen that being managed time and time again.
Yeah, well, I mean...
You don't give carte blanche necessarily to everyone who wants to drill a hole.
Well, in Australia, I think the problem has been with the boom in Australia that, in a sense, we have given carte blanche because we're allowing an unprecedented $150 billion expansion in LNG over a period of a few years and a huge increase in coal in particular as well, but also iron ore. And what that's done on a national macroeconomic level is it's played a big part, not the only part, but a big part in driving up the Australian dollar, which has really decimated our manufacturing sector in particular. And I see that as economically irresponsible because there's no reason that we should be signing off our resources as quickly as we can. I mean, there's no reason not to hang on to them for future generations, for example, because it's a one-trick pony. And if you don't capture the benefits for the community, once it's gone, it's gone, and the infrastructure that's put down is going to be there forever.
Thanks very much, Mark. Our next speaker is Mr. Robert Ells. Robin Ells has more than 40 years' experience in the securities industry. During the past 7 years, he's been executive chairman of stock exchange-listed oil and gas exploration company Lakes Oil, no liability, and chairman of the ASX-listed mining company Minotaur Exploration Limited. He's also a non-executive director of both Gippsland Offshore Petroleum Limited and Rum Jungle Uranium Limited, and chairman of London-based company Extract Energy PLC. And Rob, thank you for agreeing to come along today. It's obviously a tough audience. Your time starts now.
Thank you for inviting me. It's been a tough day. We started off the day with the state government extending the moratorium on drilling, and so it's been non-stop press and radio interviews. So thank you for having me. I'll really continue on from where I've been all day. Just firstly, I'm not involved with uranium. Rum Jungle is a phosphate company, so phosphate that many of you require, we hope to mine up in the centre of Australia and potash, so nothing to do with uranium, I don't want to go there. I'm in enough trouble with you guys as this, Adam, you wear the uranium tag. But let me just say this. Firstly, we get confused all the time with CSG, coal bed coal-seam methane. In this state, coal seam methane is controlled by a mineral license. We hold a petroleum license. So even if we wish to drill for coal seam gas, we cannot. Most of the coal seam in this state is controlled in the Gippsland Basin by ESSO and a company called Ignite. It is absolute, and while their leases coincide with ours, we have absolutely nothing to do with coal bed methane. In fact, we have three coal leases in the Gippsland area in a subsidiary company. In all cases, we have withdrawn the right to take the coal bed methane. So we've registered with the government. In no way do we want to be part of the coal bed methane. So we've forfeited those rights. So it's important that you understand the distinction. We're involved in petroleum products, which is regular stuff that's coming out of Bass Strait and out of the offshore Otway and onshore Otway. To this point, nothing commercial in Gippsland. But hopefully, in due course, we will rectify that. Now, we're looking at the water table is a common question that everybody has. And to think that I personally am not concerned about the water table with seven grandchildren, of course I'm concerned about the water table. But we're talking about a water table that's at 50 metres and we're drilling at 1.5 kilometres. So the chances of us conducting anything that's going to make contact with the water table is absolutely zero. So it's very important that you understand the science. Now today, course, the government has extended the moratorium. We've had two applications in since last September to drill a well in the Otway and another one in Gippsland. Both those applications have been cleared by the Environmental Department and have sat on the Minister's desk since December, when we were given the verbal clearance by the Environmental Department of Government. Today, of course, that approval has not been withdrawn, but it hasn't been given and won't be given until after community consultation. I welcome community consultation. Last week, I was fortunate enough to be part of a 24-member group in Adelaide that was got together, which included all government departments, with the exception of Victoria. Why Victoria chose not to be there, I don't know. But we had a very good discussion over a two-day period with the regulators in all states, and it became very clear, particularly with Queensland and South Australia, that the way forward there is community consultation. And I share the fact that you guys don't know the full facts. I believe that the science ultimately, when it's explained to you, you will feel a lot warmer. Some of you won't. There's always people that can't be convinced either way, and myself included, on our side of the fence. So I think community consultation is essential. The quicker we can get out there, and I believe the first meeting is as early as next week in Gippsland, and we're not invited, I hasten to say. This is completely independent community involvement with the government have engaged a group to carry out these consultations throughout the state. I think there were something like 15 meetings planned. We'd be delighted to be there if we're asked, but my understanding is we won't be. However, we're always free for any of you that wish to ring or email or ask questions. I'm always there to answer them, because I think that it's up to us to inform you, the landowners and the community. I'm a country boy. I was brought up in a town not bigger than what we've got out here. Went to school in the Ross Valley. I know exactly what you're going through. I've lived in the country. I understand how important it is. And I will do everything I possibly can to inform you. But I happen to have the belief that the science will win in the end.
1 minute.
And that may or may not be the case. Now, one just can't look at the technology. We've had mention of industry on my right here from Mark. I've spent the last 3 or 4 months with concerned industry making a beeline to our office because they're concerned about jobs, particularly in the Gippsland region, with the gas price escalating to forecast to be the $10 region from its current $3 to $3.50. Victoria is hooked on gas. Because we've had cheap gas in the 60s, 70s and 80s, you all have gas in your homes. Industry all has gas, and the gas price is going to jump. And we're going to see a lot of unemployment caused by the high gas price. And the unions are concerned about it as well. It's not just the industry. So anything we can do to increase the supply of gas, as we've seen in the United States, brings the gas price down. They had a gas price of $9 2 years ago. It's now down to $3.50 because of this increase in supply. Okay. Hopefully I'll get another go later. Thank you.
All right. Thanks very much, Rob. A couple of important questions arise. Do you always trust the science? And would you have trusted the science on asbestos? Would you have trusted the science on thalidomide? The people who designed the Exxon Valdez were sure that it was absolutely bulletproof, and so on. I could go on.
There's been literally, I think we've already had a number quoted, millions of holes drilled in the United States. I think the science is very well established, very well proven, and not only that, but you know, I've been in the United States in recent months. It's developing so quickly that when you drive from Houston to the well site, you're going to have a look at the next lot of technologies coming up the road behind you. It's developing very quickly. And the tons of chemicals that have been referred to, that doesn't happen. They're actually fracking with liquid gas, no chemicals.
We'll come to that, and we'll call on Damien for his expert assessment on that when we get to the next session here. When you talk about surrendering your rights, and you started off by telling us that you've voluntarily surrendered the rights to gas from the wells that you wanted to drill in Gippsland. If you've voluntarily surrendered them, what stops you from voluntarily reclaiming them?
not from wells I wish to drill. We applied for coal leases in the Gippsland region because we believe that it's the biggest brown coal deposit in the world. We are working on another company, technology which we believe we can solve the CO2 problem, and therefore we wanted to be in coal, to be able to turn coal into other resources CO2 free. So the coalbed methane, if it exists, and I doubt very seriously whether there's any commercial coalbed methane in the state, doesn't concern us. We can't get it back and forfeit it.
Forfeited it into perpetuity, or if you just suspended the rights?
No, we've lost the rights to it.
So they're not. It's not a matter of simply saying, "Oh, can we add that onto the permit you've given us now?"
No. When you apply for a permit, you have to tick certain boxes as to a mineral permit as to what minerals you're after.
Yes.
You're restrained to that selection.
But it's the oldest trick in the book for property developers to, for instance, say, "Can we have a permit for X?" And once they've got it, say, "Now can we adapt it to Y?" It's easier to adapt an existing permit than to start off with one from the beginning. So that's the way you get around some of the rules there.
Well, you may have that opinion. I don't, and I hasten to say again, we are not interested in coalbed methane. We do not believe it's there.
Community consultation, you say, is absolutely vital, and I congratulate you on being prepared to front up to what could sometimes be difficult meetings like this one. But there's been no effort by the industry or by the state government so far to have genuine community consultation whatsoever. Why not?
I believe that the last two governments, being the Labor government and the current Liberal government, have been asleep at the wheel. Back in the year 2000, which is 14 years ago, we brought to the attention of the government then the problems with CSG and the fact that it came under a Mineral Act and not under the Petroleum Act. They chose to ignore us. The two ministers that we've had in the Liberal government up until now, fortunately we've got somebody that seems to know what they're talking about in Russell North, and I'm absolutely delighted he's on board. He's a local boy from the Latrobe Valley. He understands the local problems. He understands the coal problems. And poor guy's having to put out the fires in the valley. Now he's faced with the banning of drilling. He's going through a very tough initiation, but I think he's going to be wise and strong for it. I've got a lot of time for him. The previous ministers have been overloaded. They've been given Minister for Minerals and Energy and Tourism and goodness knows what. You know, the government should look at Minister for Minerals and Energy. This is a serious problem for us all, whether we believe in it or whether we don't. It's a very serious problem.
Do any of your companies make donations to political parties?
No, we don't.
None of them at all?
Not at all.
Thank you for clarifying that. Thank you, Rob. We've got one more speaker, and then I'm going to ask some questions of the panel and draw on some of what I think are the issues that they can clarify between them. And then I'll be inviting you. We've got one microphone. In fact, I might see if we can move that mic into the middle of the floor, into the middle aisle. There's an empty mic. Oh, there is another one over there. Sorry, we've got two mics. There's one on either side of the room, so we can have two cues. And if you want to ask a question, not make a speech, sing a song, or recite a poem. If you want to ask a question, I'll ask you to take your place at the microphones. We'll get to the etiquette of that in a moment. Our final speaker is Adjunct Associate Professor Marion Carey. She works in the office of the Senior Deputy Vice-Chancellor and Deputy Vice-Chancellors of Research at Monash University. She's a member of the Management Committee of Doctors for the Environment Australia. She's worked in the Victorian Department of Human Services as a Senior Medical Advisor in Environmental Health to the Chief Health Officer and Director of Public Health. Her areas of interest include the health impact of coal seam gas, and wind farms. How appropriate. Mary, thank you for coming along.
Thank you very much. Is this thing on? Can you hear me? Oh, that's better. Thank you. Well, I'll give you 5 minutes to talk about health issues associated with unconventional gas mining, and that's a very complex topic. So in these 5 minutes, just to sort of help cover some of the general area, I'd like to give you 5 numbers to think about. So just bear with me. The first one is zero, and this represents the number of long-term epidemiological studies that have been done in Australia examining the health impacts on communities exposed to unconventional gas operations. So most of our knowledge on this topic comes from overseas, but there are still many unknowns and uncertainties. And this is why organisations such as Doctors for the Environment Australia and the AMA are concerned about the rate of expansion of this industry when so little research has been undertaken. Where there's scientific uncertainty and the potential for harm, it's appropriate to employ the precautionary principle, and that's where the onus of proof of safety is on the one undertaking the action. The next number I'd like to give you to think about is 4. 4 is the number of fracking chemicals that have been assessed by our National Chemical Regulator. We don't actually know how many fracking chemicals are used in Australia because there's no national requirement for the companies to disclose them. We do have enough information, though, to raise concerns. For example, one study of health effects of over 300 chemicals used in the US industry found that many of these were deleterious to a wide range of organ systems. Some had the potential for hormonal system disruption and increased cancer risks. The companies infer safety of the products due to the fact that some are components of household products. But just because we have hair bleach or antifreeze in a cup, it doesn't really mean that we want to drink them. Companies also say that a very small percentage of these fracking fluids consist of the chemicals, but because of the very large volumes of fluids that are used, the cumulative chemical load is actually quite considerable. Some compounds, such as benzene, for example, may not be used in the fracking fluids, but may be mobilised from underground during the process. Long-term exposure to benzene can increase cancer risk. The Australian Drinking Water Guideline for benzene is set at a concentration equivalent to one drop of water in an Olympic swimming pool. The next number I'd like to give you is 300. This is an estimate of the number of gigalitres of water the CSG industry is projected to extract per year, and I understand the shale gas industry is even more water intensive. This is approximately 3/5 of the water of Sydney Harbour annually. Water is a scarce resource in Australia, and our health depends on clean water for drinking and for food production. Water can be contaminated in a number of ways, from the chemicals used in the mining process, from the compounds which come up to the surface during the process, and from leaks and accidents of wastewater seeping down through the soil. Which brings me to my next number, which is 10. So the produced water that comes back up the well can have a salt content up to 10 times greater than seawater. It can also contain volatile organic compounds and radioactive substances. This wastewater poses problems with treatment, disposal and storage and can pose a very major risk to agricultural land and to waterways. The industry has failed to produce a clear plan of how to dispose of all this salt. Wastewater is being used currently on crops that animals eat, and we may end up eating those animals. Sometimes the water has been treated to remove the salt and contaminants, sometimes it hasn't. There are plans to inject treated wastewater into drinking water aquifers in some country towns. Recently in New South Wales, there was a water contamination incident, a CSG incident, where levels of heavy metals and uranium were found to be elevated in groundwater near a pond that was leaking produced water. So now I come to my final number, which is a fraction, a half. A study of air quality in a Colorado gas field found that living a half a mile or less close to a well gave you a greater health risk than living further away. Air pollution can occur locally around wells and transfer volatile organic pollutants into the atmosphere. These can contribute to ozone, which is a strong respiratory irritant. In the US, concerns about air pollution from oil and gas fields have resulted in new regulations being introduced early next year. I hope these 5 months numbers in 5 minutes have given you a brief insight into the key issues upon which our health depends and which may be at risk through this industry. Clean air, clean water, safe food and a healthy environment. The risks to human health from unconventional gas operations have not been adequately assessed.
1 minute.
Until we can be sure of safety, we need to employ the precautionary principle, so we need to be better safe than sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. You started off by telling
us that there have been zero studies on the long-term health effects, which is hardly surprising because there hasn't been long-term industry to study. So that's not really telling us anything that assists us understand this industry, is it?
Well, I think Damien's just been telling us that, in fact, an industry, particularly in Queensland and more latterly, New South Wales has been going for some time. And we also have examples that we can look to overseas and look at what's been happening.
So there have been
been studies overseas.
There have been some studies overseas, and they're coming through at an increasing rate. So the volume of medical literature that's coming through is increasing. One of the problems has been that this research has not been funded by government. One would think that that there would be a desire to fund these sorts of studies before the industry proceeds at this sort of rate, but that actually hasn't occurred.
The anxiety in the United States is, to some extent, now settling as people get more used to the technology, and as we've heard, there's now over a million worlds, and some of the fears people at first had are turning out now to be resolved.
I don't actually think that's the case. I think that it's almost the opposite in some sections of the community. Obviously, different parts of the country are differentially affected in different ways, and of course, issues such as how voluntary people allow access to their particular properties has an effect on how people feel about the industry. But
the health issues.
The very fact that the US government, as I've mentioned, is having to now bring in a special legislation for the air pollution created by this industry is a testament to actually the increasing concern, for instance, about air pollution risks in the industry. That's one example.
We'll consult Damien in a moment for his assessment about the fracking chemicals, but to say that there's the potential for hormonal disruption is really only saying something maybe could happen. Maybe also it doesn't happen.
Well, what we're talking about...
it's hardly science, is my point.
Well, actually it is science, because the whole field about endocrine disruptors is very well established, and... One of the problems that we do have is this lack of disclosure, the secrecy about chemicals. So it's very difficult to study things that are secret. But we do have some information coming through, and it is recognised that some of these chemicals that are used have the potential to be endocrine disruptors. And
that's my point, the potential to do something. I mean, that's the same claims made by people who are opposed to fluoride in water. They say, oh, look, this has the potential, blah, blah. But there's no study anywhere that anyone's ever found of any credibility to back up their concerns. But they still go around saying, this has the potential to do harm.
Well, I think what that shows is that, you know, in science, what we have to do is be cautious about making sweeping statements. So we say the potential because... if you have a hazard, and we know that particular hazard can be toxic, but how that is expressed in terms of human health depends on how people are exposed, how much people are exposed to, where they're exposed, and so forth. And all we're actually saying is, well, we really need to collect information on this. It's not just the information about the chemicals, it's also about how strong or how dilute the chemicals are, what routes of exposure by air or by water or by soil that could be occurring, and we really just don't have this information. In terms of the chemicals themselves, just the chemicals, even the federal government now has agreed that this is a problem and has committed several million dollars to NICNAS, the National Chemical Regulator, to start having a look at some of these chemicals. It's a little behind time, but at least that's actually starting to happen now.
Well, part of the reason I understand that's happening is in order to end some of what is, by the industry anyway, regarded as the misinformation campaign that scares people, because it's easy to make people anxious when there's nothing to reassure them. So let's come up with the studies that put some of these concerns to bed.
Well, I think it's always appropriate to have some science behind the decisions, and I think we've heard about science today, and the very fact that we don't really have answers to so many of these questions about the impacts on people means the science hasn't been done and really does need to be done.
All right. Thank you very much, Mary. Can you thank each of our panel, because they've put up with... they've put up with my impertinence enough, and now they get a chance to put up with yours as well. If you want to ask a question, there are two microphones, and I'd invite you now to make your way to them, although I do have some questions, and we're going to call on Damien to resolve some of the issues that have come up. So many of these issues, Damien, require some clarification from you and your position with the CSIRO. We'll call on you as the independent expert. And first of all, Mark's concerns about large volumes of sometimes unknown chemicals. Mary also saying we don't even know sometimes what gets pumped into the ground underneath where we live and where we commute, where we farm.
Yeah, so a discussion about hydraulic fracture chemicals. there's been a long history of various types of chemicals being used in hydraulic fracture fluids in the United States. As I said earlier, there's been a long history of development of hydraulic fracture fluids in the United States, starting in the late 40s, 1950s, and going through to the 60s, 70s, and 80s and 90s. The hydraulic fracture fluids in those early days did contain a number of chemicals, a number of them, as we were mentioning earlier, benzene in particular, which is the B of BTEX chemicals, is carcinogenic. The properties of hydraulic fracture fluids, the chemicals that are added to it are done so for particular reasons. A hydraulic fracture fluid is about 96 or so percent water, and about 3% of what is called a propant. Most common these days, the propant is silica, or sand, very pure sand. The purpose of the propant is when the water is forced into the shale under pressure, it fractures, and the propant is there to hold the fractures open. However, as we all know, when we've been down the beach and we've had a shower, sand doesn't go down the bathtub plug very well with just water alone. So we need something to carry the sand or the propant in the fluid. So another chemical is added to increase the viscosity that allows the propant to be carried. That's a gum. It's a gel or a gum that's added, and that carries the sand down the well and into the fractures. Once the sand is in place, or the propant is in place, the gum needs to be extracted. So a solvent is added to extract and wash that back out, and that flows back to the wellhead. And then to prevent algae and bacteria growing in the well, foul it, a chemical is added to prevent growth. Usually in Australia, that is bleach. In shale, we're looking at somewhere between probably 10 million and 25 million litres of water that's used for the hydraulic fracture. Somewhere
and that means per well.
Per well, per fracture. So a well may be fractured a number of times. However, depending on the nature of the shale, somewhere between about 30 and about 75% of that water returns to the surface. It's processed and then reused. So not all of that water is lost into the shale. It's important to remember that hydraulic fracturing is the means by which shale gas extraction is made economic. Without hydraulic fracturing, shale gas extraction doesn't exist. In Australia, in Northern Territory, New South Wales and Queensland, all of the chemicals that are used in the hydraulic fracturing process must, under legislation, be published on the government website. And all of the chemicals that we've been talking about, BTEX in particular, which is benzene, toluene, ethyl benzene, and xylene, are banned in Australia. So they can't be used as hydraulic fracturing fluids. Now, I'll stop there.
Sure, but I've got a supplementary question, because one of the points that Mark raised and then Robin Ells tried to respond to was about water tables.
Yep.
Now, what's your view of the competing claims made by each of them? Mark saying the water table is affected, and Rob saying no, we're well below the water table, we're drilling much deeper.
Well, the gas extraction occurs in shale, as distinct from coal seam gas, at depths below 1.5 kilometres and up to about 2.5 to 3 kilometres below the surface. The process of hydraulically fracturing that shale is such and is controlled such that the fractures are an average length based on the thickness of the shale. They can be 30 metres or up to about 90 metres or so in length. and may go a bit longer, but that's about the range. So we're talking about 1.5 to 2.5 kilometres below the surface with fractures extending around about 30 to 90 metres. All of our potable water, all of our stock water is gathered within the top 300 metres of the surface. Below that, there is not water that's suitable for agriculture or for drinking. So
if you're that much deeper, are you in any way interfering with the water table that is so much higher?
There are a number of studies in the United States that have looked at the risks from hydraulic fracturing and well management, and they place the risks associated with hydraulic fracturing orders of magnitude below other risks associated with drilling and well management.
So there is a risk, but there are bigger problems than that.
But what I'm suggesting is that the focus and the concern and regulation needs to address the higher risk issues associated with drilling and hydraulic fracturing than the fracturing itself.
Okay, so the water table is an emotional issue, of course, in particular in this country where we depend on water because it's such a vital commodity. What are the other risks then that you say are higher up the order of things to be concerned about?
So the primary risks associated with spills at the surface and transport of fluids, either fluids to a drill rig or the transport of a flowback towards to a processing plant. The risks associated with vehicle movements and that sort of thing, with spills at the surface due to equipment failure, etc., are orders of magnitude greater than the risk associated with hydraulic fracturing itself.
Are they any greater in this industry than they are in any other extracting or mining or resource intensive or energy industry?
It must be said, I think, that the safety focus of the resources industry is such that I think you would see risks equal to or less than potentially other industries.
Okay, so in other words, there's no greater risk in coal seam gas extraction from things like spillage and transport than there is with coal or with fuel, petrol, distillation, distribution and the like. And the risk to the water table is much lower than the risk, for instance, of a petrol tanker crashing.
Yes, in a sense that's correct. I mean, you must factor in the fact that you have more vehicle movements, and so per vehicle movement the risks are about the same. You have more vehicle movements. I just want to say that just so that we don't misunderstand here, the risks are not zero.
No.
They need to be managed and they need to be addressed, and that's where regulation comes in. They're definitely not zero.
No, indeed. Mark, Rob, do you want to follow up anything to the response we've had from David?
Yeah.
Mark?
Well, I think we do know that there's, because basically when they drill down a few kilometres, and the pressure down there is huge, like it's like being 3 kilometres under the sea. The thing that stops the fracking fluids and gas from getting into the migrating into the water tables at a higher level of 300 metres, as Damien was saying, was the well casing. And we know that a number of wells, statistically, a number of well casings fail. And there's been spectacular cases, like when Matt Gasco drilled a tight gas well in Kirong last year that blew and shot the well casing 200 metres.
Sure,
in the air,
and
so
we've had oil wells that have been poorly managed and there have been accidents, but does that mean you don't in any way, you kill the whole industry? No, it never has.
Well, I think you take that into account when you're deciding whether you want that industry covering vast areas of land.
Okay.
In risk.
Rob?
Yes, in our case, and now we're talking from experience, whether you like it or whether you don't, we've done 11 fracks in Victoria. 11. The only 11 that have been done by anybody, and so I think that we're speaking from experience. In all cases, safety was paramount. In all cases, the water table was also paramount. We were talking at depths of 1,500 plus, and the frack, you've got to understand what a frack is. There's been one explanation, but I'd just like to broaden that. So you've got you've got a formation that flows naturally at 20 or 30,000 cubic feet a day, which is hardly commercial. So you've got to increase the flow of the gas. We've seen it's in a conventional rock, or sandstone in our case, which in most parts of the world would be commercial, but in the Gippsland and here in the Otway, that sandstone happens to be very tight because it's very old and the gas is trapped within the pores of the rock. So we've got to release it. So what you do is you pump the fluid down the wellbore and you've predetermined where you're going to put the holes for the pressure to take place. So from the logs you can tell there's a spot at, let's say, 1,800 metres that you think that you can increase the flow from. You pump under pressure the fracking fluid. In our case, we used a mixture of water and liquid nitrogen. So the numbers you've heard about water, in our case, were not correct. We depended very heavily on liquid nitrogen. And the reason why we used liquid nitrogen was because it turns back to a gas. It's inert. It's happening all around us. We've got nitrogen in this room. So we used an inert gas that was in a liquid form. We pumped it down. As you're putting it down at about 8,000 psi, it's got nowhere to go but to crack rock. So if it cracks a rock, in our case, 50, 60 metres from the wellbore, horizontally, we put the fracking in it. Again, in our case, we used ceramic pellets, not sand, very expensive, I might add, so that when we took the pressure off, the cracks remain open, and you've taken the collection from being an 8-inch wellbore to being 50 metres either side. It only goes out laterally. It doesn't go out all around the well. So you're talking, we've increased the gathering from 8 inches to 100 metres. Obviously, you're going to increase the collection of gas to commercialise it. So that's what we do. And I think it's important that you understand what we do. That's fact. That's what we've done 11 times successfully. We've increased the wellbore, the gas successfully to commercial levels.
Okay. Marion said that we should go and be guided by the precautionary principle, Rob. And to quote Rupert Murdoch when he was concerned about global warming, if in doubt, give the benefit of the doubt to the planet. Now, if we're in doubt, and there are doubts about this technology, surely you give the benefit of the doubt to the planet, you hold off, you don't do it, and you say, well, okay, it's just not worth the risks.
No, that's not what I'm saying.
No, that's what I'm putting to you.
We don't have doubts. We are convinced that it is commercial and it is safe. As I said earlier, I welcome community consultation. I welcome the opportunity to speak to you people here tonight. And please ask me questions when you get the opportunity, if you wish, because it's important that we tell you exactly what we're doing for you to make up your minds whether it's risky, whether you want the employment. I mean, we had Sinopec here before Christmas wanting to build a $1 billion petrochemical plant. But we want jobs, don't we?
And Sam, final question from me before we go to the floor. You talked before about everything except liability for damage. If indeed this technology turns out to irreparably damage a water table or irreparably damage a landscape, who pays?
Well, that's not something that's covered under the Mineral Resources Sustainable Development Act.
Clean into land.
Sorry. So who pays, exactly? And, you know, let's have a little bit of a brief look at environmental regulation. To just briefly mention that it is a highly discretionary process in Victoria. We have a framework which focuses upon environmental effects statement rather than impact assessment, and in some instances the minister doesn't necessarily mandate an environmental effects statement for the issuance of an exploration license. Now that's a concern if we are going to go forward with whether it be coal bed methane, that's the US term for coal seam gas, or shale gas, you know, whatever framework, and shale is probably the future. And as I understand it, hydraulic fracturing is used primarily for shale gas extraction, and coal seam gas extraction relies heavily upon water pumping, but that's a different issue altogether. So we need to have a framework, and we need a regulatory framework that's going to develop the environmental assessment processes and to focus particularly on the different types of impacts that can affect the environment. And of course, in terms of liability, there is no account of the possibility that the water table will be contaminated or depleted and unable to recharge. that those sorts of long-term concerns aren't taken into account in terms of landholder compensation.
Terrific. Damien, Sam, Mark, Rob, Marion, they've all spoken. Now it's your chance. We've got half an hour until 8 o'clock for questions, and my instructions are to finish the meeting by 8 o'clock. There are two microphones. I'll alternate between them. I only have one request as we get to questions. Could you please introduce yourself as you ask your question? We'll start over this side. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, John. I'm Bruce, and my question is for Rob. The extraction of gas, and I hope it will be more important questions tonight, but the extraction of gas is to produce wealth for your shareholders. And this wealth comes from the state, who owns the minerals, which own the minerals. What level of mineral tax is the industry expecting to compensate the state for the wealth it's extracting?
Thank you, Bruce.
The answer to that question is quite straightforward. The Petroleum Act puts a 10% tax on the income that we generate. It's pre any expenses. So whatever comes out of the ground, we tax at 10%, and that goes to the state. Now, at the moment, most of the resources are offshore, and the revenue goes to the federal government. So the state government's getting virtually nothing out of offshore oil and gas.
Are there any additional, other than that, is what normal company taxes?
Normal company taxes, payroll tax and all those sorts of things. And we did hear earlier that we don't employ very many people. Well, that's correct directly, but indirectly it's many thousands. I mean, if you look at some of the industry that's already established using gas, I mean, the car industry, for instance, uses a lot of gas. And there are people in this room that I can see that use a lot of gas, so we won't go into who they are. So, you know, there's a huge employment on the back of gas. And can I just broaden that? Or
sure.
It's very important for you people that believe in renewables, and I think we all do. We'd all like to see renewable as the solution to this. But the truth is that the sun doesn't shine all the time, the wind doesn't blow all the time, and therefore we have to have another source of power to fill in those times when there's no wind or no sun. Coal is a dirty word, and coal takes 4 or 5 hours to power up. So if it's windy this morning, and all of a sudden it drops at lunchtime, it's 4 o'clock this afternoon before you can bring the coal-fired power stations back on stream. Wind, you can do it. With gas, you can do it in 10 minutes.
All right. Mark, did you want to respond on the renewables issue, which is something you've also been vocal about?
Yeah, sure. I mean, the renewables, you know, we've got solar thermal power where you can store energy. And dispatch it when you need to. So energy storage isn't a problem, particularly in Australia where we've got such a great resource. And, you know, the Australian Energy Market Operator did a 100% renewable energy scenario for Australia and found it was completely feasible. So, and the problem is with gas, you know, aside from the environmental issues, it's getting so expensive that nobody's thinking of building a new power station, gas-fired power station at this point.
Good on you. Thank you. Next question over there.
Hi, my name's Phil from Geelong. And we've heard that in the US there's been more than a million wells drilled. My understanding is that the majority of those wells have depleted very quickly, 60% in the first year. And there's been a large impact on communities and risk to the environment for a relatively small amount of gas produced. So my question is to Rob and Els. Rob, what do you expect the depletion rates to be in tight gas fields in Victoria? And why, given that your company is named Lakes Oil, not Lakes Gas, have you switched from oil to gas?
Good on you. Thank you for your question, Phil.
Firstly, we're very proud of our name. We were formed in 1947. We're the only Victorian oil and gas company. We were formed at Lakes Entrance in 1947, and we were taken over by Woodside in 1957. In 1987, the company was taken out of Woodside and relisted. So it's your company, and there's 16,000 shareholders. Half of those people live in Gippsland, so we're very conscious of that. In relation to the drop-off of wells, yes, they do drop off. but then they continue at a steady rate for 20 or 30 years. And you know, I haven't bought the material here, but I'm quite willing to talk to you after the meeting and to take you through some of the production charts. And you're probably looking at a 50% drop off in the first 12 months, another 10 to 20% in the second 12 months, and then flat line for 20 years. In the US, they're not only now self-sustainable, but they're looking at exporting gas, whereas 10 years ago they were looking at importing it. So the US has now gone from a deficit to a surplus.
And David, did you want to join on the technical side of that?
Reiterate that the energy budget, I guess, for the United States is completely revolutionised in the last 10 years. It's not true that the gas and liquid fuels that have been generated from shale have depleted. In fact, it's exactly the opposite. If the government in the United States approves exports, we will see much more liquefied natural gas flowing to Asia from the United States.
And it's completely turned on its head what used to be the understood and conventional wisdom of global energy supply, which is not at all what it used to be. America now exports rather than imports. It's no longer dependent on Middle Eastern oil and on the other.
Exactly. I mean, put it in context, where we're building three LNG trains at Curtis Island in Queensland. It is the potential in the United States is there to build 11 LNG trains on the East Coast.
11. All right, third question over here.
Graham Stockton from Melbourne. My question follows on from the last one, and there has been, it seems, some arguments about how much resource there is available as opposed to how much recoverable resource there is. And Nafiz Ahmed in The Guardian recently talked about how there's been a huge down projection from billions to millions in terms of the recoverable gas that's available, and they're saying that it might peak between 2015 and 2017. And also Richard Heinberg from the Post Carbon Institute, who's done independent studies, is also reflecting that figure. And also, whilst they seem to have overestimated the recoverable resource, they're also talking about fugitive emissions of methane, which are much higher than what the original projections were meant to be.
And your question is?
My question is, would maybe Damien like to comment on that?
In relation to the resource, the amount of economically recoverable resource, of course, depends on the technology to explore and extract it, as well as the price of the commodity. Currently, in Australia, put into perspective, we have about 400 trillion cubic feet of shale gas reserves being reported, and about 200 trillion cubic feet of coal seam gas. That's about equivalent to the United States, at about 600 trillion cubic feet, and China has a bit over a billion cubic feet of shale gas. So the United States Geological Survey, a number of other studies looking at global reserves, show no downturn in either liquid fuels or gas supply heading out beyond 2030. In fact, increasing. There's a drop off in conventional oil and gas reserves, but not in shale.
So, in simpler language, if you can excuse me for this, but there's heaps of it there. We've got lots of it, and it's worth a squillion
at the moment. What we don't have in this country is a large amount of infrastructure to extract, transport, and process the gas.
But we're sitting on a windfall if we can find a safe and a sustainable way of exploiting it and exporting it.
They are our petroleum resources.
They are our resources. They're globally attractive. They provide for this country a potential massive windfall if we can find the right way of getting it out.
Yeah, potentially.
Is that a conventional way of putting it?
That's
okay.
Right. The other part of the question was on methane emissions.
It was fugitive emissions, I think was the question.
Yep, that's right. So fugitive emissions are the emissions that escape during the drilling, completion of wells, extraction and processing. Rule of thumb, if we're talking around about 1% to 2% fugitive emissions, then the greenhouse associated benefits of gas for electricity production outweigh that of coal. If we're talking about in the order of 3 to 5% or beyond, then the balance flips the other way. You don't get the greenhouse benefits from using natural gas or shale gas. At the moment, there is a considerable amount of literature coming out from the United States looking at various ways of measuring fugitive emissions. I won't go into the details, it's quite a lot of information, but there's a reason to suspect that the fugitive emissions are tending towards the lower end of that range of, say, 1 to 8. In CSIRO, we're undertaking research in Queensland looking at fugitive emissions in the coal seam gas industry.
Terrific. Thanks, Damien. Over on the left.
Thanks, John. Malcolm Gardner from Killoran. Question for Damien. Damien, where do these millions of megalitres of water come from used in the system?
For hydraulic fracturing?
Well, you're talking about, somebody was mentioning 300 million litres.
Right.
Even if you do reuse it, where is it coming from? Where do you source that water from?
Generally, and it depends where you are and what shale formation you're drilling into, but as a rule, shale gas extraction doesn't produce water. Coal seam gas production produces water. And in Queensland, we're seeing, because the methane is held under pressure, it's actually dissolved in the water and attached to the coal itself. Under pressure, it remains dissolved. In coal seam gas, the coal seam needs to be depressurised by taking the water out. And so we're looking at around about 100 gigalitres a year at full production in Queensland, in the Surat Basin, in terms of the amount of water that will be brought to the surface. In shale gas, the amount of water that is used, as we've mentioned before, it's somewhere between, depending on the formation and the well size, etc., somewhere between about 5 and 25 million litres.
And Malcolm's question was, where does it come from?
Where does that come from? That can come from a variety of sources. It can be taken from groundwater of various quality. It can be salty groundwater. It requires the engineers to design the fluid so it performs at the purposes that it's designed to do. So there is some limits on what water can be used. But the successful management of water in a system requires that sharing of that water between, for example, agriculture and the resources.
In fact, it's competing with agriculture, isn't it, Rob? And the argument from the industry is that using available water for this industry is a better use of water than using the water for agriculture because it makes more money for Australia.
That's
is that not right? That's
not the argument. As somebody, as I said earlier, that has carried out 11 fracks in the state in Gippsland, we found the best results we had during the 11 fracks that we did was to use water, salty water, that actually came out of the well at about 1,500 metres. So we actually used water that had come from the formation that was salty. It wasn't quite as salty as seawater, but it wasn't far off it. We mixed it with liquid nitrogen and we put it down there. And then afterwards, when we brought it to the surface, we disposed of it at the Datsun Downs sewage farm.
So it's water that didn't have an agricultural application?
And no use at all.
Okay. And
there's very good reason that you could use salt water out of sea if you were allowed to, but you wouldn't be allowed to.
Why wouldn't you?
Because I don't think the authorities would allow you to take sea water.
Which authorities?
The
government. State government?
Yeah.
I can't see why not. What's the concern?
Well, we've had that discussion.
Have you? All right, well, that's an interesting point. So the argument goes, though, as I understand it, that the gas industry's potential returns and earnings for the nation ought to take precedence over using water. If indeed there is a competition, you're saying in this instance there hasn't been, but if there was, your argument is this is a better economic use of water in gas than in fact for agriculture.
No, my argument was that by using water that came out of the formation that we intended to frack, we had a better result than you introducing foreign water being fresh water.
All right. Anyone else on the panel on water? Mark?
Look, Rob may have found a new way of doing it, but the fact is that the way that it's done overseas, so you use somewhere between 11 and 30 million litres of water, and Rob's company, if this field goes into production, Rob will sell to an oil and gas major, probably a global major, and they'll do it the way that they can most economically extract the gas. And they'll, and they may not follow Rob's way with salty water. And I also would have thought that salty water would be a risk to the well casing because you've got your steel well casing too. So I want to be really careful with the...
Well, I'm sure, Rob, you've got billions of dollars at stake, you wouldn't be careful, but you're saying you're using salty water.
The water's down there for all of an hour and a half to 2 hours, so it's not going to do much damage in that time.
Okay.
And as far as selling to a foreigner, we have absolutely no intention of doing that. In fact, I've made public statements saying that we won't even sell gas into Queensland.
Take that as you will. Anyone got an update on the State of Origin score for us while we're at it? Yeah, okay, over here. Thank you very much. Your turn, sir.
Yeah, thank you, John. My name's Les, and we're down on the Cape Otway Road, and we sincerely hope that the Barwon River is not used for fracking. My question is to Professor Hepburn about compensation, and I was a little unclear about the nature of the compensation that could be involved should the mineral rights be exercised by a company. I'd just like to say that we were in MacArthur and Santos gave us an option to build a pipeline, a gas pipeline through our property. It was a bit of a disaster in some ways because in the MacArthur pub where I was one night, I found that my neighbour on the same sort of deal had in fact extracted a very, very favourable compensation. And my heart fell as I found that my compensation was significantly less than his. But fortunately, there was someone else in the pub who came along and said that he had even a worse deal than I had. So in fact, I left the MacArthur pub very happy, some ways due to the compensation payments, but also due to the imbibing of some brown liquid from within the pub.
Thank you, Les, but your question is?
My question is, with compensation, is it a VCAT matter, or is it a part of the Act that may be passed by the State Parliament?
Okay, thanks, Les. Yeah, that's a great question. Look, it can be a VCAT matter. If you go to VCAT because consent to access the land hasn't been given, then VCAT will evaluate the compensation agreement, and they'll take into account the range of considerations that are set out in the legislation, which includes such things as loss of amenity, disturbance, obviously impact upon surface industry estates. It doesn't include the loss of the mineral or the petroleum because it doesn't belong to you. So those sorts of factors. It doesn't include, as I said before, costs associated with legal costs. If you have to go and see a lawyer to have some sort of discussion on negotiation tactics, proceed. So it doesn't include that. It also doesn't include possible future impacts that, depending on what your surface estate industry is, it won't include, if there is some sort of contamination or depletion on the water, that's a predictive issue. So it's really going to assess compensation at the point when you're seeking it, and that's what the factors take into account. So if you don't go to VCAT, you can enter into a private arrangement. That may be something that you did. And then, of course, that just depends on your negotiation skills. And it might mean that your neighbour did go and get some sort of legal advice, or maybe just had stronger negotiation tactics. I'm not sure.
Or spent less time in the pub.
Spent less time in the pub. Yeah, absolutely.
tons of ores from Burnsville to the Queensland coast. I'd like to show you a map.
Just keep the microphone up near your mouth or we can't hear what you're saying.
It's a map of the Queensland.
You've got to keep the microphone near your mouth, Noel, or we can't hear a word.
That's a map of the Queensland Great Artesian Basin.
Yep.
It runs right down to here,
okay.
Across the lake here and back.
And your question is?
My question is, who gave permission to poison Australian people's water and ours?
That's a question to who?
Mark, please.
That's a question to Mark. That's a bit of a Dorothy Dix to the Mark.
Well, I guess approval for that was given by the Queensland government and back in 2010, I think, with those to let those projects go ahead, and the federal government had to sign off on it with a piece of legislation called the EPBC. So, both the state and federal governments are the ones that approved those projects.
Damien, can I call on your expertise? I mean, how do you feel about, the question obviously is a very emotional one, how do you feel about the language poisoning the people's water?
Well, it is an emotional question. I guess there's a couple of things. Firstly, that there is not the injection of BTEX into the coal seams. Secondly, it is possible to have naturally occurring BTEX in coal. Our data suggests that it does occur, but at very, very low concentrations. It's only detectable very occasionally in the coal measures in Queensland that we've looked at in the Surat Basin.
So has the Artesian Basin, has the underground water been in any way poisoned?
There is absolutely no evidence, no data that suggests that the Great Artesian Basin has been poisoned, if you like.
Has it been in any way compromised at all?
No. The amount of water in the Great Artesian Basin, the reserve of water there compared to the water that's coming from the coal measures, which sit above the Artesian Basin aquifers, that amount of water is tiny compared to the resource that's there in the Great Artesian Basin.
All right, thank you for your question. Let's open this side. That's a question to
Damien.
Thank you, Damien.
There's no doubt that we need more studies on health impacts, as what has been talked about earlier tonight. The Queensland Department of Health in, I think it was 2010 or 2011, undertook a study of the incidence of number of these afflictions in the Tara region and concluded that the incidence was no higher than outside of the region. That's not to say that there isn't an issue there. What they're saying is that they haven't seen a higher incidence. If there is an issue, it can't be the methane itself. Methane is odorless, colourless, and essentially non-toxic. The other thing is that we've had a coal industry in Queensland for more than 50 years. That coal is quite gassy. It's the same seams from which the methane is extracted. Those coal miners have been, the coal has vented, the methane has vented off, but those miners have been in a methane-rich environment for decades, and there are no incidences or higher incidences of issues. not the methane if there's a problem. It must be something that comes with the methane. And the gas that comes out of the Surat Basin is some of the most pure coal seam gas in the world. It is virtually entirely methane, and it has no hydrocarbons, volatile organic carbons, and no BTEX chemicals. So in a sense, it's fortunate that region, the gas that's being extracted, is a very pure source of natural gas. That contrasts to places like, for example, there's an area of Colorado where there's shale gas extraction. The gas that is extracted from there does have volatile organic compounds in it. It also has benzene and other compounds that interact with the atmosphere and generate ozone. So there are air quality issues associated with that particular region. There are about 45,000 shale wells in that region, and it's located fairly close to Denver. And so there's an interaction between the air quality from Denver as well as from the shale area. I mean, I can go on, but...
clearly. Yeah. Marion, this is a really important issue, about, you know, our technical expertise in the room is already, for many of us, challenged by where we've gone, so, you know, we get lost. But, Marion, in the area of public health, I mean, surely the state health departments around the country need to come up between them with one thorough and rigorous study that puts these things to rest. What's so hard about actually doing it?
Well, unfortunately, there are, I suppose, conflicting interests within state governments, and generally state governments have been pushing as fast as possible, and they haven't been funding these sorts of studies, as I said. And I've actually presented evidence at a number of coal seam gas inquiries, both Senate and State, and there's never been any state health department there giving evidence, I can tell you. So it's not something that's really been on the agenda. I think it's starting to become on the agenda now, which is a good thing.
Let me flip this back then to you, Rob. If the industry wants a social contract, in other words, if you want support, surely it's in the industry's interests, if you're as confident as you say you are, to get these studies done.
Very much so. But just before I answer that question, I just want to follow on about the air quality in Denver. Denver's just legalised smoking of pot, or maybe all the bad air is not necessarily coming out of the wells.
There's something about cause and effect there, I know there is. Yes, please.
My name is Jacinta Morahan. I'm from Anglesey. I've got two very short questions for Damien. For a government body like this, CSIRO, it's important for conflicts of interest to be declared. Given the very close relationship your department and the unconventional gas industry clearly has, do you think a conflict of interest needs to be declared? And how much funding or sponsorship do you and your department receive from the unconventional gas industry?
Very good question. Thank you. There are conflict of interest issues, and there are perceptions of conflict of interest that need to be managed as well. And disclosure is the means. On one hand, CSIRO does do work with industry. That's the I in CSIRO, and we do pre-competitive work for I grant. Funded work for industry of all different types, including the natural gas industry all over Australia. Most of that work is around assessing and characterising resources, improving the engineering associated with drilling and extraction, improving productivity, reducing the use of water and that sort of thing. That's all funded by industry and that's directed towards industry. When it comes to our environment and social work associated with the coal seam gas and shale gas sector, we have a body, an alliance, called the Gas Industry Social and Environmental Research Alliance, GISERA. And I would recommend that yourself and everybody here, if they want to find out much more about what we do in this space, go to the webpage, gisera.org.au. On that page, all of the research that CSIRO does in relation to environment and social issues is published. All of the funding is disclosed. All of the grant proposals are up there for you to see. All of the reports and the outputs. The way that I'll just very quickly, just to so that we're absolutely clear about this, the way that Jazeera works is that in this case, two companies, APLNG and QGC in Queensland, along with CSIRO, put money into a trust. That trust is managed by a research advisory committee. The research advisory committee is composed of a number of members from CSIRO, industry, and stakeholders, in particular from stakeholders in Queensland. The way the advisory committee is set up is that the number of agriculture and external stakeholders on that committee must be equal to or exceed the number of industry and CSIRO representatives on that committee.
Are you able in your work to criticise the industry?
Absolutely.
Do you have absolute independence enshrined in the agreement?
Absolutely, 100% independence. The distribution of funds and the decision on which projects get done are done by the committee, not by
the industry. We're out of time. I'll allow one more question and then Heather Wellington will thank everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I'm Edie Fisher, Sidcreshire Greens Councillor. Just a question for you, Rob. We had at our council meeting last night, the Dean's Marsh Frack-Free people presented to us. 96.4% of their community does not want fracking in their area. I'm not sure about the Winchester community or the rest of this ward, but I want to ask you, and this has not been covered tonight, do you plan to put your fracking wells on the land of people who don't want it there and you'll force your 10 grand, your 20 grand, your 50 grand to them and frack anyway, or will you actually listen to the community?
I think I made my feelings quite plain at the beginning, saying I welcome the consultation with the community. I welcome it, and happy to talk to you afterwards. 96% of sea spray is not a very big place, as you well know. And the area that we intend to work, if we ever get to work it, and there's no certainty that we will, we already own the land, so we won't be putting ourselves into anybody's farms. We already own the farms.
But the principal issue at stake here is that the law allows you to go ahead on people's land even if they're not happy with it. Would you, if push came to shove, would you do so?
Well, as I said initially, if we are ever allowed, and there's no certainty that we will be restricting ourselves to our own land. Now, that's
but after that, if
after that, we may well go into a broader area. And if you look at the data that we've published, the next area we would be looking at is pine forest. So, you know, the people that own the pine forest.
Would you ever foresee a position where you would go onto private land against the wishes of the landowner?
Never against the wishes, because there's the opportunity to go to VCAT and hopefully to resolve the problem that may take place.
Okay. There's the answer to your question, and that's where the conversation has to end only for tonight. I'm about to hand over to Heather Wellington, who will issue the formal votes of thanks. But can I just say to every single one of you, you have done the most powerful thing that a community can do. In Ukraine, in Bangkok, all over the world, there are people dying for the opportunity, literally dying, laying down their lives for the opportunity to do what we have done tonight, which is to come together as a community, debate an idea, test what people have to say, engage in the contest of ideas, and make up our own minds. I think that is the most exciting thing about living in Australia. It's a wonderful feature of our way of life. Heather will ask you to thank each and every one of the panel, and I want to thank you all for coming along first, though. Heather, thank you.
Thank you very much, and good evening, everyone. I've been asked by the Business and Tourism Association to pass a vote of thanks to our panel and to John. It was the aim of the association this evening to inform and entertain you, and I hope you'll agree that we've succeeded in that aim. Our panel of Damien, Samantha, Mark, Rob and Mary, you've all done a fantastic job. All of them volunteered their time. Most of them came from Melbourne, Damien came from Brisbane. And they've come down to Winchester to help to inform us more about this really topical issue in our community. I think they've been frank and open in their answers, and they have helped to both inform and entertain us. Would you please join in thanking them for their contribution? And we do have some nice hampers of beautiful local winter city produce for our panel members. John, we were absolutely thrilled when John agreed to come to Winchelsea. We knew we needed a really strong and moderator this evening, and John, of course, has lived up to his reputation of being prepared to ask the very difficult questions. We thank you, John, on behalf of the Winchelsea Business and Tourism Association for a wonderful event. I'd like to just briefly acknowledge the work of the steering committee that put this event together. It's fantastic to see so many people here at the Winchelsea Hub, and it didn't come about without a lot of work. We had a steering committee of Sandra Jones, Tony Phelps, Ray King and Stuart Fountain, and I worked with that group as well. All of those people put in many hours to organising the event, and it was also supported by a much larger number of members of the Business and Tourism Association. So thank you all to all the members of the steering committee and their supporters for your efforts. We had some very much appreciated sponsorship from our wonderful IGA supermarket in Winchelsea. We also had great support from Music Workshop with the audio tonight, which was a really important part of the evening for us. And we also had a very generous donation from a member of the community who is here tonight, who supported the delivery of that audio system. So thank you very much to that person. We had a generous community grant from Surf Coast Shire to assist with the event tonight as well. So thank you very much to the Shire. And finally, the Winchelsea Star, which is our very much valued local community newspaper, gave us wonderful publicity, which resulted in you all knowing about the event and coming along tonight. I'd just finally like to say thank you all. You've been great. It's great to see so many people engaging in this kind of information and idea sharing opportunity. So thanks all for supporting it. I do hope you enjoyed it, and wish you all a very safe trip home.